Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the 2024 LA Festival of Books. My name is Dr. Alyssa V. Richardson, and I'm an associate professor of journalism here in this building in USC's Annenberg School. I'm also the founding director of the Charlotta Bash Journalism and Justice Lab, which studies how African Americans use media to protest and to report on protest. And lastly, I'm the author of Bearing Witness While Black, African Americans, Smartphones, and a New Protest Journalism. And I'm really, really excited today to talk to some of my esteemed colleagues here at USC and to introduce you to them. A little bit of housekeeping before I do so, though. I would like to introduce these brilliant scholars momentarily, but repeat that we should silence our cell phones. And also, I'd like to share a little bit about the format today. First, we will talk a little bit about these three incredible books. Then we'll open up the discussion to you, the audience, for questions. Immediately following our panel, you can visit each of these authors in Signing Area 10 of Wallace Annenberg Hall if you would like to meet anyone up close and personal and get your book signed. So without further ado, allow me to introduce my colleagues in alphabetical order. Wolf Gruner holds the Shapell-Guerin Chair in Jewish Studies and has been professor of history here at USC since 2008. He's the founding director of the USC Dornsife Center for Advanced Genocide Research. He's a specialist in the history of the Holocaust and in comparative genocide studies. Additional areas of research include the comparative history of mass violence and its resistance on a global scale, as well as racial and state discrimination against indigenous and other minority populations, especially in Latin America. Dr. Gruner was a postdoctoral fellow at Harvard University, Yad Vashem Jerusalem, the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, Women's Christian University Tokyo, and the Center for Jewish Studies Berlin-Brandenburg, as well as the Desmond E. Lee Visiting Professor for Global Awareness at Webster University in St. Louis. Dr. Gruner is the author of 11 books. Today he will discuss his latest, Resistors, How Ordinary Jews Fought Hitler's Persecution, which is a finalist for the National Jewish Book Award. Dr. Susan Kamei is the author of the award-winning book, When Can We Go Back to America? Voices of Japanese American Incarceration During World War II. A descendant of incarcerees, Dr. Kamei draws upon family and community stories to convey the continuing relevance of this tragic episode in our history to contemporary issues of racial identity, immigration, and citizenship, and the threat to civil liberties today. Recognized as one of our country's most prominent scholars on Japanese American incarceration, she has appeared in national and international broadcasts by news outlets such as NPR, NBC, C-SPAN, BBC, and France 24. Here at USC, Dr. Kamei is an adjunct professor of history, teaching a popular undergraduate course she created on race, our Constitution, and national security. She's also an affiliate faculty of the USC Ito Center for Japanese Religions and Cultures, continuing her research on the Japanese American incarceration experience. Lastly, but not least, Dr. Haja Yadiha is the assistant professor of sociology at the University of Southern California and faculty affiliate of the USC Equity Research Institute. Dr. Yazdia researches the politics of inclusion and exclusion, examining the forces that bring us together and keep us apart as we work to forge collective futures. In addition to award-winning articles, she is the author of the book we'll discuss today, The Struggle for the People's King, How Politics Transformed the Memory of the Civil Rights Movement. She's also a public scholar whose writing and research has been featured in outlets, including the Los Angeles Times, Time Magazine, The Hill, and The Griot. Please help me welcome our authors. So hello, everyone. My first question is for all of you. Can each of you who have written such incredibly rich and beautiful books about the way that ordinary people stand up and protest when they see things wrong, give us a brief introduction of not only yourself, but your book? I'll start with you, Susan.
Oh, okay. I thought we were going to go alphabetical. Sure. Well, hello, everyone. It's such a thrill to get to be with you and to be on the stage with some wonderful colleagues and friends. The book for me, as Alyssa mentioned in the intro, is a personal story. It's a family story. My parents and their and grandparents and their families were among those that were incarcerated during World War II. On February 19, 1942, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt issued Executive Order 9066, which gave the U.S. military the authority to forcibly remove, more than 125,000 persons of Japanese ancestry and into a program that detained them indefinitely through the duration of the war. Now, two-thirds of those were American-born citizens. That was my father and mother's generation. They were babies, toddlers, children, teenagers, young adults. And the impact of this upon their lives as they were forcibly removed is something that has continued to reverberate intergenerationally. The veneer of compliance came about that what is mostly not known was that the U.S. Congress made it a crime not to comply with these military exclusion orders. It was also enforced and carried out by the Army and the soldiers, as my parents and other incarcerees said, the soldiers had guns and bayonets that were pointed at us. There was also the propaganda, the political justification that they would show their loyalty by smoothly concurring and abiding by the process that the government euphemistically called an evacuation. Usually when there's an evacuation, you're moving people from a threat, but in this case, they were considered the threat. The other aspect was that there was a social and cultural, deeply rooted cultural traditions and sensibilities that to bear things with dignity and to not cause trouble. So the combination of these factors meant that along with the trauma of their experience that these stories were not told, and that the impression was that they went along with this willingly. But under the surface, there were many different forms of protest and resistance. There's the constitutional issues that were brought about by the three test cases. If you have heard of Korematsu, there was also the case brought by Minyasui's conviction and Gordon Hirabayashi's conviction, and another case that is not well known was brought by a woman, a habeas corpus case to the Supreme Court. And all three of those criminal cases upheld the constitutionality of this in 1944. But one of the best examples, I think, of resistance and protests were by the young Nisei men that at the time of the war were precluded from volunteering or being part of the military, but then as the war wore on, the government reinstituted the draft. And so these were men that, in young men, teenagers really, that were in camp and asked to sign and fill out a questionnaire that became known as a loyalty questionnaire. And there was a group that answered no to the question, would they willingly serve the US government? So they became known as no-no boys because there were two questions, no to each question. Another group actually protested that they were being drafted, even though this was a country that considered them to be disloyal enough that we needed to remove them and imprison them, but now loyal enough to serve as a drafted member of the military. And their position was, well, when I have been restored my rights as a U.S. citizen, then I will comply with the draft. So they became known as the draft resistors. Mm-hmm. To juxtapose that against those who either volunteered, from including behind the barbed wire in the camps, or thousands that were drafted and served valiantly in the 100th Battalion and the 442nd Regimental Combat Team in the bloodiest battles in Europe today, still the most decorated unit in American military history for its size and length of service, and also in the Pacific and the Military Intelligence Service. And in a way, I consider them resistors as well, even though they complied with either the draft or voluntarily served, because they were protesting, they were pushing against the notion that the Japanese Americans were disloyal.
Wonderful. Wolf, will you please share a little bit about your book and your motivation for writing it?
First of all, thanks for coming and give us the opportunity to share some of our thoughts about our books. So I'm a historian of the Holocaust most of all, and I studied the Holocaust for like 20 years when I was sitting in an archive in Berlin. And I looked at a source which nobody had really looked at, police diaries from police precincts in Berlin. And I found this one entry among thousands of other handwritten entries, like stolen bicycles, drunk people, and so on. This one note about the arrest of a Jewish man who protested against the persecution of the Jews in Nazi Germany. And this struck me for two reasons. One of the kind of, at the time, our understanding of Jewish resistance was mainly focusing on armed resistance, group resistance, organized resistance, and mainly kind of located in Eastern Europe, but not in Nazi Germany proper. Second of all, this was an individual. There was nothing organized about it. Suddenly, kind of, I realized this is an area we never have looked at into. I was very intrigued and started to collect materials. It took me 12 years of research and in total 14 years to write a book because it was tremendously different to actually locate sources. So the base of my book are records from police in Berlin, but then I also located material in Frankfurt, Hamburg, Dresden, Leipzig. I included Vienna and Munich. Then also court materials, because Jews were actually who spoke up in public against persecution were tried and put on trial and then punished with prison time. And then I added kind of 170 interviews from the USC Shaw Foundation, which is located here, of Jewish survivors who also shared some story. They never actually called it resistance, but in my view, I think we need to call these smaller acts of resistance, like public protest and others, as resistance. And what I did in the book, first, I redefined what resistance is, in my view, and just by including individual acts, which regarding the Holocaust, they were never included. It was always kind of group organized and armed. Second, when you have this different perspective or different definition of individual acts, suddenly a lot of things kind of appear or surface which we never really looked at as resistance. So for example, I had such a variety of cases after several years of research that I needed to kind of bring some organization to this, the huge variety of the acts. And so I came up with five categories of individual resistance. One is kind of contesting Nazi propaganda and anti-Jewish propaganda. Second is public protest. Then the third is disobedience of laws and local regulations. The fourth is written protest. And the fifth, which was the most surprising, is actually physical self-defense by individuals, Jewish individuals. And my book is kind of organized along these five categories. Each chapter tells a story of one act of resistance. I dive into, and this is, took a long time to research this, into the biographies of these people to kind of come closer to an idea why they actually did this. Not just that they did this and documented, but also to understand better why they did this. After each story, I add other stories to show that this one representative story for this one category is just the tip of the iceberg. And I think with the book, I can actually not only challenge, but I think after you will read this book, I don't think that you will share anymore the idea that Jews were passive, because these individual acts were so widespread, and they were so common, and they were so also done by kind of ordinary Jews, men and women, young and old. So I think that the main message of the book is actually to rethink the idea of Jewish resistance, making Jewish passivity during the Holocaust obsolete as an idea, and also show that when Jews could do this, everybody is capable of doing this.
Thank you, Wolf. Haja, tell us a little bit about your book and what inspired you to write it.
First of all, this is such a joy to have our books in conversation. There are so many connections between them, so I'm super excited about our conversation today. So for me, coming to my book was really a story of me being not just a sociologist, but also a daughter of Iranian political refugees, growing up in these predominantly white communities. And so much of my existence has been shaped by these questions of identity and belonging and where do I fit in? And so growing up, for me, the histories of the Black freedom struggle were always these sources of inspiration. They were kind of lifelines, seeing just everyday people, especially young people, coming together and creating so much change. And so, you know, I'm in graduate school, it's the Obama era, and I'm watching this politics play out where there's a real reaction to having the first Black president. I'm hearing a lot of this language of white victimhood and reverse racism. And what was particularly notable for me is that I was noticing how Dr. King's name kept getting invoked. So Martin Luther King Jr.'s words would be invoked to say that he would be opposed to things like affirmative action, that he wouldn't believe we need all of these voting rights kind of regulations, and that they infringe on state rights. And so I'm thinking, how do we get to this point where Dr. King's words can be used in such a decontextualized way? And I'm sure, you know, many of you have noticed this. This is something that plays out in politics all the time, where Dr. King's name gets used in just kind of crazy ways. And so I traced it. I traced the uses and the misuses of Dr. King's invocations for 40 years, from 1980 to 2020, all across the political spectrum. So groups ranging from the animal rights movement to gun rights activists, family values activists, immigrant rights activists. And through these chapters, I basically pair movements. And so in one, I'm looking specifically at how the immigrant rights movement is taking the civil rights memory, how it's opposed by nativists. In another, it's the Muslim rights movement. They're opposed by the anti-Islam movement. Another is LGBTQ activists opposed by family values activists. And what I find across all these chapters is that increasingly since the 1980s, it's really these right-wing groups that are picking up the memory of civil rights. They are turning it on its head and using it for their own purposes to claim that they are the new victims under multicultural democracy. And so it's that trend that actually helped me understand that kind of the grievance politics we're seeing today, the quote-unquote anti-woke culture wars, these are not just a product of the Trump presidency or even the reactionary politics after Obama, but rather that this is a long trajectory that dates back to the gains of the civil rights movement and then the reactionary politics it inspired. And so for me, the big takeaway is really thinking about, first of all, this idea that the uses of memory are intentional strategies, but then second, that they have these concrete consequences. So they're used in the service of rolling back civil rights, rolling back democracy. But then I think the hopeful piece, and the piece that I think we're going to talk more about, is that there's also a really powerful way of reclaiming memory as a strategy of resistance. And I think this is something both of your books speak to as well. The idea that memory itself is a form of resistance. And so I think that's really one of the pieces that I hope to leave us with after we leave here today.
Thank you, Haja. What I was really excited about in reading all three of your books as they began to come into the mail and I'm pouring through these is not only how rich they are in human and personal anecdotes, but how much of your own identity is woven into the exploration of what these various protests have meant. Can you talk a little bit about how identity and how your own research is intersectional and how it looks at different layers of race and class and religion even to talk about how people protested during your respective eras? I realize they're several years apart in where you've studied, but what were the intersections that you were mining?
One of the aspects of the government evaluation of what constituted loyalty or someone that could be trusted to be aligned with America, the United States versus Japan as a wartime enemy was religion. That the predominantly Japanese American community were Buddhist and a little bit of Shinto, but not for the most part Christian. And so in that questionnaire that got disseminated in the War Relocation Authority, what known as the camps, really the detention facilities, was the questions that if you answered of a religion that was Buddhist, Shinto, or non-Christian, then there were disloyalty points against you. And then, of course, if you were Christian, that was plus loyalty points. And so we focus a lot on the Japanese American incarceration about it being race-based. But as Duncan Williams, who was on an earlier panel in the festival this morning, has often said, professional religion here has often said that, well, you don't have to scratch very far underneath the surface to also see that this was religious discrimination as well.
I think that's perfect, because I don't think that we normally think of those two things going together in respect with this point in history. We always think that it was based on an ethnic identity, so I love that. Any other connections between intersectionality in your work? Anyone can take this.
Yeah, no, I'm happy to, because it's something I thought about a lot. I mean, I know when we think about, you know, the making of the memory of the civil rights movement, so many times we think about Dr. King. We think about him as kind of the face of civil rights. We think about the way that he symbolizes, you know, the March on Washington, him standing up there giving that I Have a Dream speech. And yet in the book, one of the ways that these grassroots movements are really trying to resurrect the true radical histories of the civil rights movement is through this intersectional lens, where they are picking up on the invisibilized, untold stories of the Black women, the queer folk, the poor folk, who were so central to the organization, to all of the hard on-the-ground work of the civil rights movement, and putting their bodies on the line day in and day out. And so I think when we really take that intersectional lens, it's both the story of, you know, what stories get told, whose voices are heard, but then also, what do those silences tell us about how power works, about the way that we think about resistance and what true resistance should look like? And so I think that that's really, for me, one of the places where there's a powerful opportunity to reclaim some of these pasts and bring them into the present and try to forge more intersectional futures.
As you might have noticed, I have a strong German accent, so I'm originally from Germany. But to be more precise, I grew up in East Germany, so under communism in a dictatorship. And much of my work is actually kind of motivated by my personal experience as kind of someone. At the time, I had not even studied history. I was an artist, I was a writer, and was part of this kind of cultural underground. That's what it was called. And the interesting thing, and here it kind of connects to the theme of intersectionality, in this cultural underground in Berlin, all kinds of different groups who were not kind of part of the regime or were distant to the regime actually met, coexisted, cooperated, and sometimes also just had pure joy together. Punks, rock musicians, painters, photographers, political dissidents, gay people, practically everybody out of the mainstream was part of this underground. And I think this, not only my personal experience as being discriminated against and losing opportunities in East Germany, but more to see that the discrimination is never isolated against one group. It is always kind of intersected. And I think that was a big motivation for my work on, although I focus on the Holocaust in my work, in general, kind of to look more into comparative issues. But even if we take the Holocaust, our understanding that the Nazis persecuted the Jews is a very reductive idea, because the Jews, as the Nazis persecuted them, never existed. It was a construction. There were Jews who were for two generations Protestants. Yeah, there were Jews who were atheists. There were, I mean, there is a huge variety, socially, culturally, class-based, and also gender. And in my book, I think the interesting kind of throughout line is, for example, when we think about gender, that one old stereotype, I think, is also abolished with my book, that men are more prone to be resistors than women, because almost in some cases, more women actually resisted in various ways than men. But the same is true, for example, when we think about age, that usually we think, oh, resistance is usually done by young people or young men. My book shows young women, but it also shows elderly men and elderly women. Yeah, over 17 years old. One of the main chapters is of a 71-year-old Jewish man from Munich who writes anonymous leaflets cursing and insulting Hitler. And he pays with his life for this. So, and another story is of a 16-year-old girl which kind of stabs a stormtrooper. So that's kind of the range of stories you can find when you are looking for them.
One of the things that I like about all of your books is that they give a voice to folks who have been ignored previously in the retelling of history. How might we interpret your books as a form of resistance themselves?
Well, I'm happy to go first. Yeah, you know, I think about this so much because oftentimes when we think about like books that are about the civil rights movement or Dr. King, we think of them as histories. And I always say, I'm not a historian, I'm a sociologist. And in fact, I'm actually very bad at history myself. I never remember specific facts and names and dates. But the book is a history of the misuses of Dr. King. And so for me, when I'm really thinking about, you know, this question of the book itself as a form of resistance, I think it is a resistance to the dominant narrative, which is the one we so often take for granted, the one that's handed down to us. It's the one that we learn in schools. It's the one that we celebrate on national holidays. I mean, in the book, I even lay out the making of the King holiday and the way that President Reagan, I mean, he did not like civil rights. He did not like Dr. King. He had no intention of memorializing King through this holiday. But it had been a 15-year battle with Coretta Scott King at the forefront, really fighting to institutionalize King, have us remember the civil rights movement in this collective way. And so Reagan then sees it as this opportunity. He says, all right, well, if the political pressure has built to this point, they've got the votes, and I'm going to have to sign this bill, then I'm going to use it to my advantage. And so he makes sure, and he writes this in letters behind the scenes, that we are going to remember a very selective version of Dr. King. It's going to be one that's marked by erasing all of that radical history. We're not going to remember that he was opposed to racism, militarism, and capitalism. We're going to remember him as somebody who solved the problem of racism. So this is not something we need to deal with anymore. We're going to think of him as a symbol of American exceptionalism, of individualism, the power of a free market. And so then during Reagan's presidency, he uses King time and again to then roll back those same civil rights that King had fought for in his lifetime. And so that tells you something about the way that these dominant narratives are shaped, the way that they're handed down, they become entrenched, and in fact, they remake the way that we collectively remember the past and think about the present. And so that's one of the ways that I think about the book as a form of resistance, because it's telling us this is not, for one thing, the accurate story, but I think for another, it's telling us to really ask that question of why is this what we've been taught? Why have those other stories been left out? And it's when we ask those questions that I think we really see how power is keeping us from understanding the power that we have as a people.
I'm going to tag on to that because Ronald Reagan plays a big role in the Japanese American incarceration story because he was the president who signed the Civil Liberties Act of 1988 that gave the government recognition that the wartime actions were wrong and provided token reparations payments to the then survivors. And there was a hook of the narrative for Ronald Reagan as an individual because as a army captain in the war, he was part of a celebration of one of the members of the 442nd, those soldiers that I was telling you about, who had been killed in Italy. And coming out of the war and realizing that now we have to release these that we, because we thought that they were so dangerous and now the West Coast didn't want them back. Now the government realized we have to reverse our narrative. We have to go into a PR rehabilitation campaign and say, oh no, we should welcome them back because we have a soldier that died and his family wants to bury him in a cemetery that would not allow somebody who was not white to be buried there, and we should welcome him back as a hero. And Captain Ronald Reagan was someone who spoke at that ceremony and said some famous words about all the blood that is spilled into the sand is of one color and that sort of thing. And this was, he was reminded of this in the 1980s that you were part of this history, Captain Reagan, and that he was reminded of this and saw this as an opportunity to say, well, this is an American issue. This is not a civil rights issue. This was a civil liberties issue, and one that is of America. But I entirely concur with the idea that the stories that are left out and not told are part of being able to keep history written the way it was euphemistically or falsely written from the war, and it perpetuates today. Those are the kinds of questions and comments that I get in public events. They go, well, you have to understand we were at war with, and the phrase is you people, this blurring, this misunderstanding that it's a shared ancestry, but not one of loyalty, citizenship, or patriotism.
Yeah, I mean, so many themes are kind of overlapping, and I think it's really important to think about resistance of our books can be kind of challenging how memory is constructed. And I think one thing my book tries to do is to really get rid, as I mentioned in the beginning, of the notion of that Jews didn't resist. And somehow this kind of is used somehow to legitimize that the Nazis could persecute them because they didn't resist, so it was their fault, which is kind of very skewed. But I would also say that what I try to do, and this can also be seen as a kind of resistance, is to uncover these small acts and to show not only that Jews were actors themselves, that they were active, that they had agencies, but these acts are important. And often this is difficult to understand when you live in an open society where sometimes small acts don't have consequences. And just to give you an example, not from Nazi Germany, I don't know if you remember when the invasion of the Ukraine happened, there was a woman sitting on the Red Square with a blank sheet of paper. There was nothing written on it. She was arrested for anti-war propaganda. So that's what I mean. It is sometimes small things, yeah, which are perceived by regimes as kind of dangerous, and that's what we need to understand is resistance. And there are many connections because there are kind of parallels with kind of the slavery, Jim Crow here in the United States. I was just in South Africa presenting my book, and people reminded me that actually the categories I pose in my book were really well placed also for the resistance under apartheid, actually.
So we were talking about small acts, maybe being against something negative, but one of the impressions that I had as I was working through the material and working through the manuscript is that there's so many tragic, hard, heartbreaking stories, and I would seize upon the stories of kindness when someone did something that wasn't necessary but was compassionate or thoughtful, and they might not even know how much it meant, to how much it changed the life of one of the incarcerees and put them on a better life trajectory after the war. And I think that those kindnesses and those small, you know, often anonymous acts were also part of, I think, the helping resist the negativity of the situation. I'll tell a story. My father was a high school freshman when Pearl Harbor was bombed, and graduated from a camp high school, spent his entire 4 years of high school behind barbed wire. There was a Quaker school teacher, and she served as the vice principal and math teacher in my father's camp high school, and saw that he was promising, and that he wanted to go on to, after he could get out of camp and after the war, wanted eventually to be able to study engineering. And there was a program that the Quakers ran in alliance with the Presbyterian and other, you know, Christian organizations to help place the students in camp with universities, colleges, usually small in the Midwest, that would allow them to come. And my father's teacher, Mrs. Georgia Robertson, wrote to one of her Quaker friends, who was the registrar at Iowa State College, as was then called Iowa State University now, and said, I have a student here, this course is unaccredited high school diploma, and is there any way that he could come to Iowa State? And he said, well, if he comes and takes an entrance exam and passes the entrance exam that I'll administer him, then we'll let him come. And so my father took the $25 and a train ticket and nothing else and got himself to Des Moines and passed this test and registered for one semester, and then he got his draft notice. Okay. Came back to California, served in the Army, and now has the GI Bill. But he had that one transcript with one semester at Iowa State College, right? And so he's out of the Army, and he comes back to, he's from Orange County farming family, and applies to Caltech. And he gets a letter that says Caltech wants to be in touch with him, and he takes the train, the bus, the red car, and another bus, and gets himself to Caltech. And they said, well, Mr. Kamei, we have your application, and that's nice, but you don't have a high school diploma. And he pulls the transcript from Iowa State College out of his pocket, and he said, well, I have this transcript from Iowa State. Could I be considered a transfer student? And the way he told the story to me many times is they looked at each other from behind the desk, and one of them finally says, welcome to Caltech, Mr. Kamei. And he reversed his red car, back to Orange County, picked up very few belongings that he had, farm boy, you know, living in a practically a shack that his family had built, you know, very, very humble circumstances, and went back to Caltech before anybody figured out that they shouldn't have let me in. For the rest of his life, you know, stayed in touch with this Quaker missionary, and attributes everything in life to the fact that she was willing to write to one of her colleagues and work that out for him, which just changed everything for him in his life and consequently my family's life.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. One of the things that also struck me about your research as I'm having these books in conversation with each other in my head is that the common pushback that you may hear to reading history, and some of you have already suggested it, is that these things have happened so long ago, why study them? In fact, a lot of the rhetoric from various political parties may be that it's water under the bridge 90 years ago, if we're thinking about U.S. slavery hundreds of years ago.
It's all happening today.
Yes, I want to know, can you give us some examples of some very clear things that are happening right now that are tied to your book? And I'd like you to go first, Susan, because I'm thinking specifically of the alien land laws that are being discussed in the U.S. South right now.
Yeah, we talked about this in our prep call. So at the turn of the century into the 1920s and then continuing after that, California led the way, unfortunately, but there were other states that enacted laws that prevented aliens, and they would define what constituted an alien, as ineligible to own real estate or to have, in California's case, long-term leases more than 3 years. I did not realize that that's why my father's family that rented land as farmers moved every couple of years, because it was they couldn't have a lease longer than 3 years. So these were laws that really prevented the accumulation of wealth in most cases, stayed on the books for decades. The most recent one to be struck down was in 2021, and you can guess a state. It was Florida. But then just last May, Ron DeSantis, the Governor DeSantis of Florida, signed into law a new alien land law, this against citizens of China and other countries, and under the guise of we have to keep communists from owning land in the U.S. And the rhetoric and the vocabulary was exactly the same as in the turn of the century alien land laws. The difference in Florida versus a state such as Texas was that in Florida, it caught the Asian American community off guard. There wasn't an existing political or community coalition that was in place to mobilize to take action against it getting to the point of it being introduced into the legislature and then with the votes that enabled it to be passed. Whereas in Texas, there are existing political community groups that were already working in alliance with one another. And when the bills started to be floated in Texas, they were successful in beating it back. And so now what the community in Florida is learning is to take some of these legal and political plays out of the other playbooks in other communities to be able to now try to fight against these alien land laws that have already been enacted in Florida.
I'll just add to that because Florida for sure plays into some of the parallels I see as well. When we look at groups like Moms for Liberty, the groups that are trying to essentially ban racial education in schools, they're banning books. These are the parents that are showing up at the city council meetings, the school board meetings, and they're standing outside with these signs fighting woke culture inside schools. They are not unlike those parents that were fighting desegregation. I mean, those parallels are apparent. But I think the other parallels that we see are actually in the criminalization of protest. I mean, this is a real issue right now where Supreme Court, you know, has banned forms of protest in three states. It's spreading widely. You could look at the crackdown on Columbia University's campus. I mean, thinking about even the way that people talk about protest, they talk about these young activists as agitators, as communists, as anti-American. These are the very things that they called civil rights protesters. These are the very things that they called Dr. King. And I actually wrote an op-ed in Time magazine about this because I think the way that King has been sanitized has us thinking that he was beloved by all, that he never ruffled any feathers, you know, that he was just wearing his nice suits and saying really nice things and making people feel good. But if you read any of the newspapers from that time, I mean, the way that folks really hated him, the way that even journalists, when he was on the cover of Time magazine as Man of the Year, that cover story, I encourage you to go read, because they take down his style. They call him like wearing funeral clothes all the time. They say he has no sense of humor. They say that he's not even particularly smart or organized. One thing they give him is that he's charismatic. But so when you think about the way that they talk about protesters back then, the way they try to discredit them today, those parallels tell you something about the power of the people when they come together and the way that power wants to shut down any narrative that upholds and heroizes these people that are actually just trying to fight the status quo. So I think that's one way that I definitely see parallels.
Adding to this from a very different side. So on the one hand, you have kind of communalization of resistance. But then on the other hand, we have also this tendency to make heroes out of resistors. And that's kind of, I think, a very wrong attitude, because it distanced them from us. And for a lot of young people, the problem is they see these heroes and say, I could never be this. And I think important is really to understand resistors are ordinary people. Sometimes they are more creative than others. Sometimes they are joining movements. But I think important is they are like us. And I think what I do in my book is, for example, is really demolishing the idea that you need certain characters, a certain upbringing, certain kind of conditions to be kind of a resistor or act as commit acts of resistance. And I think when Jewish young people in Germany could set off wrong fire alarms to divert the firefighters from the actual bombing sites when the British Air Force came, I mean, then creativity is all without limits, also today, I think. And I think it's important to bring this message for young people, especially to make them understand they can. Everybody can do this. It's just up to us to make this decision.
And I want to draw that idea out of it more. Thank you, Wolf. Before I open it up to questions, what are some lessons that you hope modern activists and organizers learn from your book? Susan, would you like to start?
I think that we don't know necessarily the impact of what we do, and might not ever know the good that might come of what we do. I think of so many of the stories that are in my book, and many of the individuals that are whose voices are in there are in many cases people that I was fortunate to personally know. Many I did not. But when I learned more about the context of their earlier lives before I got to know them, that I realized that they were acting, and there's so many situations were so different and called for taking into account so many complex considerations. But they were following through on their principles. They were following through on what they thought was what they believed in, what they thought was right, and they were willing to accept the consequences, whatever they may have been, and that they didn't necessarily know at the time what was going to come of it. I think of Gordon Hirabayashi, who was a junior at University of Washington, came from a Quaker background and was opposed to war in general and just could not see, as a matter of conscience, going along with the exclusion order, and turned himself into the FBI and then became the test case, one of the three test cases. But he did not know that his case was going to end up in the Supreme Court. He just was operating on his consciousness. And so I think that for whatever the legacy becomes is something that we only are able to appreciate retrospectively, but that I think we honor the bravery, we honor the acts of conscience as they are offered up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I actually would love to just...
Go ahead.
Because I want to end on the thing I started with, which is that remembrance is resistance. And it's something I'm thinking about so much today, because I think as we think about even your own work, Professor Richardson, the idea of bearing witness. I mean, I think this is what we're seeing with social media and the way that we're bearing witness and that Palestinians are writing their existence into the record, that we are observing it, that it's the same histories of indigenous peoples, it's the histories of Black Americans, of peoples all across the globe, all across history, is that those stories become forms of resistance and saying, this is our lifeblood. You may erase us from the record, you may erase our existence, you may try to legitimize our oppression through the stories that you tell, but we will keep our stories and they will keep us alive. And so I think that's so central. And then I think the second piece for me is related to that, which is that from these histories, we can use memories as this expansive bridge. They aren't just things that happened, right? These are models, these are blueprints for solidarity politics, for us coming together and remembering that we are not separate, that the divide and conquer politics is a strategy to keep us powerless. And so I think that's really where you can draw on the past and see well, we have been in community with one another. We have worked together before, and that when we come together, we are unstoppable.
Thank you. Thank you. At this point, I'd like to open it up to the audience and see if anyone has any questions. The microphone is here on the side. I believe we'll have a runner bring it to you. Thank you.
Thank you. There's an elephant in the room, of course, and this being a panel on resistance and protest, and the elephant, of course, is the young woman who was prevented from giving the commencement speech, the valedictorian at USC. Since this is a panel on resistance and protest, I'd be interested in the reaction of the four USC professors vis-a-vis I'll be honest, this abhorrent action by the president of the university. Abhorrent.
Over to Wolf.
Yeah, I think many of us faculty share kind of these sentiments. And just that you know, I wrote a letter to the president and the provost 2 days ago, and it was today published in the Daily Trojan. I'm I was a teacher of ASNA, but that's not the matter. It's a matter of principle. It's about free speech, and it's kind of, if you, and this is the title of the Daily Trojan article, if you punish personal opinions, that's the first step into authoritarianism. And that's coming from my personal experience in East Germany.
So one of the code words during World War II with the action against persons of Japanese ancestry was military necessity. We needed to do, and the premise of the Korematsu case was we have, it's in our right as the executive branch to be able to determine what is in the interest of our country, what is necessary for a militarily successful prosecution of the war. And we don't have to tell you our reasons, and we don't have to tell you what the issues are. You just get to believe us, and this is the Korematsu decision. And so these are the echoes that I heard in the provost's comment.
Hear, hear. I completely stand with that. I'm like, you said it better than I could. We've signed every petition. You've written letters. And at this point, I think standing with our student protesters arm in arm and making sure that, you know, they're not standing alone, that they know that any little bit of power that we have as faculty, we are with them. I think that's like, what else can we do, right?
Can I add one sentence? I was amazed, to be honest, because I started trying to organize faculty. The polarization which we are in now, right now, and it was mentioned, the division, right, is also creating silences between us. And I think the most important thing, what I realized, is how many people think similar, in a similar manner, but you don't know about it if you unless you speak to them. Mm-hmm.
And one more thing, because I know you want to ask your question. I think one of the biggest things that protest movements battle is silence. And silence is a form of agreeing with that dominant narrative. And so I think by signing petitions, as I have, as my colleagues have done, we are showing students that we're standing with them. And it can be very difficult when the First Amendment does not apply to student press. But this should not have been an instance where this was even a question. She should unequivocally be able to speak. And I think that that's some of the things that the faculty have been discussing this week. Sir.
Hi. Thank you very much for the allowing me to ask a question. First of all, a commonality among all of the participants here is that the belief for freedom of speech. Actually, I believe the United States is so different than the rest of the world because of freedom of speech, which is under attack, actually, continuously. And we've seen it with that case, the Japanese Americans, and so on and so on. Mm-hmm. So my question, and also the fear that you just mentioned, you mentioned about the fear, I has to do also with freedom of speech. People not, actually, they're afraid even to express their opinions because they're afraid of repercussions. So I would like to hear your opinion about what do you think about the case where the government collaborates with big corporations to basically silence people. And we have cases like, thank God for Elon Musk actually brought up the Twitter files, and we can see in reality that agencies like NSA, CIA, FBI collaborate with big organizations, which I call them government organizations, because YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, all of these guys, they're collaborating very closely. I'm from the technology space, and I know from the 80s that there was close collaboration with the government, so they're basically an extension of the government. So what do you think, each one of you, about these cases, which I believe they are appalling? I mean, they are actually going against the freedom of speech, which is really the basic right and the basic principle and right of humans in order to have a democracy. Without freedom of speech, you don't have a democracy. And nowadays, I see tremendous attack on the freedom of speech in a point where my friends, and I can see here with the professors, they are afraid even to speak because they think that they're going to be prosecuted by the government. This is appalling. This is not America any longer.
Mm-hmm. Anyone like to speak to this first?
maybe just a personal impression. What I was struck by was when I moved here to the United States, the contradiction on the one hand, kind of the idea of individual freedom, freedom of expression, but also privacy, right? Your private rights. And then that there is no movement at all that these big corporations invade our privacy by taking our information and selling them. And there is no movement against this. The benefit and profit of these big corporations of our private information, I think that's the huge contradiction which I see here, and I think there should be something done about this. We should all profit from if our information is sold from this selling of information. Mm-hmm. And we should control it better.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I mean, I think about this so much, and my students are concerned about this too. I mean, they think all the time about all of these forms of repression and surveillance that are so abundant and that shape their career prospects and the way that they even think about having a voice. And so, I mean, for me, it's first of all the idea that we've never really had freedom of speech. It's never been equally distributed, right? There are the folks that have had more power. They have had more kind of capacity to say what they believe without real consequences. And then also as a Middle Eastern person, you know, who has seen the post 9/11 landscape for the past 20 years, I certainly know firsthand what it is to not feel like you can speak freely, even though there are others who may be able to express critical opinions without quite the same consequence. But I also think that we should be heartened by the movements that are arising from the grassroots right now. Because though we're seeing so much crackdown, even though we're seeing so much repression and so much of it's, you know, kind of invisible, a lot of the surveillance behind the scenes, people getting fired without a lot of fuss or ado, I think the other piece we should feel good about is that there is a growing politics of refusal. And I think Gen Z gives me a lot of hope in that, because they truly have seen that the rest of us are kind of failing at trying to reinvent the wheel every time. And they are committed to doing things differently. They are committed not to playing the same games and trying to reform things within the system. And though it might seem scary, I also think that they show us a way forward. So that's really where my hope lies.
Thank you. I think each of your books gives us such hope. And I think that is something that we need today in a very complex world that we're living in, when there are various conflicts around the world that are grabbing at our attention. It can sometimes make you feel powerless. And I think one of the things that I'm gleaning from each of your works is that even the smallest act can be considered resistance. So I do hope that all of you indulge in their books and really take advantage of all of the wisdom that they've poured into this.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.